Hello, everyone. My name's Larry Robin. I'm the director of the Moonstone Arts Center, and I am technologically challenged, and this is our first virtual reading. Yeah, I've kind of resisted virtual reality. And everything I'm about to say is kind of a lie. It's in the normal circumstances, does about 80 poetry readings and publishes about 25 books a year. Of course, this isn't normal circumstances, so all of that's a lie. Right? But I'll make believe it isn't, right? So we do about 80 poetry readings in four venues, including a TV show on PhillyCam called Philly Loves Poetry, which is an interview reading series Tuesday of the month at 6:30. We're at Fergie's, which is currently closed, every Wednesday, and we'll continue to do Wednesday programs virtually and just build up to our weekly. Yes. One in July. We're starting on August 5th, on Steptoe hosting Black Lives Matter reading, and we'll probably do two or three in August, and then by September get into doing something every Wednesday. If you go to our website, you'll see that we have four anthologies that people can submit to. Like I said, we did about 25 books a year, usually an anthology every month or so. The anthologies tend to be on social issues, though not always. One of the anthologies that we're collecting submissions to is on the virus, which I had in April, and I can't write about it at all. But people are invited to write about what the virus has meant to them, what it has done to them, how do they respond to it. So one of the things, the focus of Moonstone is the significance of art, both in terms of personal development and social development. And our poetry readings fit into that category. Our interest is in creating audience and allowing poets to read their poetry, to expand their audiences. I'll say that our biggest event is called Poetry Inc. This year was the 24th year we're doing it. It keeps getting postponed because of the virus, but it's 100 poets reading, 3 minutes apiece, 6-7 hours, and we invite everyone to participate. And again, you can participate in this on our website through submittable. We invite people to participate. It's not an open reading, you have to pre-sign up, but then we put everyone in alphabetical order, so you don't get to read with your friends and you don't get to choose what you're going to hear. And that's very deliberate, again, in terms of how important art is in allowing you to express yourself and expand the world you live in, hearing people that you would never go hear by choice. And there it is, you know, you say, oh, I only like sonnets, but the person reading before you is does a spoken word piece, and the people after you does a haiku. And, you know, you perhaps would have never gone to hear someone doing these, but there you are in the middle of it. And that's what Moonstone does. Tonight's host is Aaren Perry, and he will introduce everyone else. Welcome, Aaren.
Hey, everybody. Poetry series. You're going to do for the camera if you want. This was originally scheduled for part of my Moonstone humor and poetry series in April. It was to have occurred in April, but the end of the world as we knew it interceded, and here we are at a time when humor is not what we are leading with. You will hear some humor, but that's just one thing poetry does, along with mindfully filling this physical distancing void with some social nearness, which we now have in front of us. So bring it on in, and let's have the first reader. Elijah B. Pringle is a Philadelphia poet, lyric baritone, which you will experience, composer, actor, and activist, and he's the author of At the Cornerstone, Feeding the Sparrow, Second Saturday at Serenity, and Optic Problem and Other Illusions. He has appeared on radio, TV, and stage, and he's been quoted in print in Newsweek, New York Times, and Philadelphia Daily News, as well as other periodicals. And he credits his true education to five generations of teachers. So give a warm Zoom welcome to Elijah Pringle.
Hello, hello, hello. Thank you. I want to thank Larry for continuing Moonstone and to understand that, you know, just like the Guggenheim Press, we have to accept advances. It'll work, I promise you. I am not a humorist, but I do use humor, so I want to share some pieces that have elements of humor and also some pieces that are a little bit more serious about the current situation. So the first poem I would like to share is about my love life, which in itself is rather humorous. And this is called The Equation. The things that are given transforms into variables. I replace X with expectation, only to discover reasonings why does not intersect with X. But what does is my desire, and longing is a tangent that touches life at a point, only to never intersect again. Desire has no will to bow. Reality is elliptical, obtruse, comes around, goes around. I need something about a circle, a curve, an arc. Desire should be an arrow that has truth's aim. It is not rigid and unbending. It leaves reality, then re-enters the plane to strike the target. Gravity pulls it back to Earth. An arrow's trajectory is a bow. Unlike the cord eyes witness, a fixed line is obsessive desire, intersecting the circle of life at hope and re-piercing it at regret. It's secant, not tangent to the sphere of existence, yet as perpetual as pi, life is congruent with real. Even when we opt to be 3.14, yearning that the number rounded will come close to the real sum that we expect. My mother will always say, be careful what you ask for. And this one's called And God Listened. Thinking about you 23 hours a day, 6 days a week, then I spent the whole day praying, asking God for another hour to the day, asking God for another day to the week. Now we get on each other's nerves 24/7. The next piece is something that I had written as a sort of an ode to Maya Angelou. And this is called Veleity, which is a wish that you really don't want. I wish my gluteus wasn't so mountainous in arms this long. I hope that my legs and thighs weren't so slave strong. I desire my pupil wasn't a constant deep true brow. I fancy my hair wasn't so kinky sitting upon this crown. I yearn that my nose wasn't so broad as truth's breath. I dreamt my skin had no melanin shielding my health. When the soles of my feet make my turbulent pants calm, I crave that my complete hand was the color of palms. For you'll never see the one thing I learned in my youth. Words falling from the fullest lips are liberating the truth. So that's my ode to Maya. The next pieces I'd like to share are form poetries. This first one is actually a fiction. It's a short fiction. It's only 55 words. It has a beginning, middle, and end, and it's called Hidden Treasures. He was high all the time, so he wasn't much for learning. His mother would yell and hide her money in his school books. Left alone again, while she got her groove on, he became frustrated. So he decided to finally open his mind. When the money fell out, he hid it on the stove. So that's a 45-word story. Has to have a beginning, middle, and end. And obviously, the moral of the story was the fact that he wasn't a student and she wasn't much of a mother because, you know, he hid it there on the stove because it would take her a while to find it. The next piece is actually a poem that starts with the letter A and ends with Z. So it's an A to Z poem. And actually, the next four poems are for 45. And hopefully, you all know who 45 is. So the first poem is an A to Z poem. A bitter creation does everything for greed. He infers justice knowing lies mature, not omniscient proclamation, quasi-reasoning, semi-truth, usually ritual wars. Xenogenetic yapping zygote. Limerick for 45. Once was a man with very little hands who said he was king throughout the land. He found every way on the poor ones to prey, then hawked them a castle made out of sand. There once was a man from the land of Queens who did so many things that seemed quite obscene. His puppets gave reason what he did wasn't treason, as he picked your pocket then ripped out your spleen. By the way, for those of you who don't know, the spleen is part of your immune system. And without the spleen, you basically will be attacked by this virus. But anyway, the last piece is a limerick, and it's more in the traditional form of a limerick. But I promise you, I don't get dirty because I love Lynn. I don't want her to be disappointed with me. Make the land great was the ultimate trick, and fooling the masses gave him his kicks. They bowed at his whim, and he got behind them, and before they knew it, he was with his... So anyway, you can fill in the blank and figure out what it was. next piece is a little bit more serious, in keeping with my writing. This one is called What If Slaves? What if slaves had microchips that could locate them? Let's call them cell phones. What if slaves had restrictions around their legs to slow them down? Let's call it sagging. What if slaves had tits to suck on and never be weaned? Let's call it crack pipes. What if slaves had a new lice that crawled on their scalp? Let's call it superglued weaves. What if slaves had a new tribalism to pit one against the other? Let's call it complexion. What if slaves harvested a new perennial abundance? Let's call it homophobia, apathy, misogyny, ham. What if slaves could cross over Jordan? Would they dunk or be baptized? Let's call it church hoop dreams. What if slaves had ankle bracelets? Wait, they do. Then I guess they're still shackled. The next piece is for my brother, Owari Osoyunde, and it's called White Privilege Means. White privilege means when the police drive behind your brand new car, you don't drive imagining your own death. White privilege means when they make room for you, it's legacy, not affirmative action. White privilege means when you go into the store simply to browse, you don't have to be aware of a spying escort. White privilege means when you make a statement, you're not questioned or doubted. White privilege means when people look at your name, you don't worry that your resume will become 2 points in office basketball. White privilege means when you get a promotion, you got it because you deserved it. White privilege means when you go for a mortgage, you don't get points subtracted because of your hood. White privilege means when you watch TV, your image is everywhere. You're not missing. You're not a person on a milk carton. White privilege means when your children go to school, you don't worry if there's enough textbook. White privilege means that when you open the Miss History books, you will be there unchained and unscarred. White privilege means when you take a respectful knee, you won't be fired and demonized. White privilege means that when the umpteenth mass murderer is found, you don't get stereotyped as dangerous. White privilege means when you trace your family tree, you ain't depicted as monkeys swinging from branch to branch. White privilege means when you ignore what you have placidly condoned, you willingly give up your relationship with the truth. And I just would like to say that that piece is not an attack on white people. It's basically on what we refer to as a white mindset. And a white mindset is often, believe it or not, housed in the bodies of those who have melanin. So to me, it is a societal thing. It is not just a people thing. But as I was telling someone, that whenever we see this injustice and we don't speak out about it, then we are guilty of that injustice ourselves. The last piece I'd like to share is called Social Distancing or Drapetomania. And this is for my friend Eileen Castaneto. And I'll explain. The word drapetomania was a medical condition that was listed in 1851 that said that the reason why slaves ran away was because they were suffering from drapetomania. Not that they wanted to be free, but they had a mental illness. Social distancing or drapetomania for Eileen. Only social distance we've known is justice. 6 feet can be either horizontal or vertical. Si es pies de separado or 6 feet under. Justice has kept its distancia para mí. The end of justice is injustice. It is alive. It is not a virus. It is a bacteria swarming in a petri dish, a culture of white supremacy. It propagates on denial, festers in flawed reasoning and justification, grows exponentially on hatred. This is not a healing or helpful strain. It does not aid in digestion. It does not make milk cheese, and there is no antibiotic unless we become a cure. But too many eat at the feast, fugu, with its toxicity intact. Venom can be found in the liver, in the eyes, in the skin, in the ovary, and when you become insensitive, it is because you are now it. You are the thing in which you have feasted and festered on. And now we are rankled. Our faces wrinkled with disbelief, not at what is, but that you are annoyed that we are not gleeful at our own oppression. Drapetomania in a 21st century twist, that there is something wrong when we amble through the preamble to create a more perfect union. I want to thank Larry for this opportunity. I want to thank Aaron for asking me. And I hope that there was some humor in it and some enlightenment. But thank you, guys. I appreciate this.
Awesome. Fantastic work. As always, Elijah, thank you for those tried and true pieces and the new ones. It sounds like you've been writing a lot, as I'm sure everybody on this Zoom call has. I'm sure everybody on this call is going to come out with a new book after this isolation, but nice work, man. Thank you. Speaking of all the people on this call, we have an awesome turnout. Thank you for coming to this Moonstone grand reopening when there's at least four other major readings going on in Philadelphia area tonight. But moving on to the next to the next writer. I met Lynn a while back in Philadelphia, and then we share an alma mater in Vermont College of Fine Art. She has truly taken flight since that program. And Lynn Levin is the author of 5 collections of poems: The Minor Virtues, Miss Plastique, Fair Creatures of an Hour, Imaginarium, and A Few Questions About Paradise. She is with Valerie Fox, author of this Craft of Poetry book, Poems for Writing, Prompts for Poets. And she's the translator from the Spanish of Birds on the Kiswar Tree, a collection of poems by Peruvian Andean poet Odie Gonzalez. So Lynn Levin's poems and translations and essays and short stories have been all over the place. Plowshares, Boulevard, the Hopkins Review, Wild River Review, Verse Daily. She was on Garrison Keillor's radio show, The Writer's Almanac. She teaches at Drexel. You can always find, she's a delight as a teacher and an activist and a fellow artist. Please welcome Lynn Levin.
Well, thank you, Aaron, and thank you so much, Larry and Aaron and everybody for being here. And for Larry, I'm so glad Moonstone's back in business. All right, so I'm going to be reading from my new book, The Minor Virtues. Just came out this March, and you can find it on Amazon, and Shakespeare and Company can get it for you in the Doylestown Bookshop. So the Minor Virtues section of this book concentrates on tiny little practices that, when looked at fancifully, might extend into deeper or larger things. So I will start with buying produce from the markdown cart. I rescue them at times from the back of the store, cellophaned oranges and apples packaged, good side up. I imagine them as little brains, thinking of the days when they were on the tree and full of promise. Mostly I leave the rusty beans, blotched pears to the gleaners, calling to mind my days as a gleaner at Dominic's and Star, when I approached with furtive hunch the scratched and bruised, bought them with my meager pay. What a bounty of salads and pies they made me who saved them from the heat. More than anything, I hate waste, and yet how much of my own life have I let go unused? Fixing broken things. Some objects are beyond repair, a shattered glass, an obsolete computer, an old wife who must be swapped for one who's younger, cuter, a home exploded by a storm, a busted reputation, a banged up auto only good for scrap, a kidney damaged senior cat. Think then of things not completely lost, though by gravity and clumsiness attacked. Consider kintsugi, the Japanese art of piecing back broken bowls with golden glue, the shining men's, the imperfections honored, the damaged, the storied, treasured just as much as new, or even more. Witness the prodigal redeemed after his many falls, the tales you don't want to hear, though he's rebuilt clean and sober now, and stronger at the seams, for all you know. The Milk of Human Kindness, which, believe it or not, is based on a true incident. The Milk of Human Kindness. Once I had an epiphany in a church. It happened at a nursing mother's circle many years ago. We sat on folding chairs in the fellowship room, opening our peekaboo blouses, none of us modest, caught up in the rapture of that blessed year or so. We traded tips about work, daycare, breast pumps, which department stores had mother's lounges, sisterly things. One night, a new mom came to us, shadowed with a less than look, as if she felt she had no place among us, the lucky ones, the ones with plenty of milk. She said she failed at nursing, tried, but her baby never got enough. Confessed, she turned to the bottle. Then she unbuttoned her shirt, put her daughter to her breast, and asked what she was doing wrong. I felt for her, We all did. The baby was trying but coming up dry. Then the kid started to cry. "Give me your baby," our leader said. She cradled the other woman's child in her arms and breastfed her. The little stranger latched on like a pro, drank her fill in the silent room. It broke on me like an egg. This was the milk of human kindness. Almost every other good thing I've ever seen has paled before the vision of that evening. Thank you. All right, so switching gears. So just as Larry says, you know, he hates technology, I hate it at least as much as Larry. And this one is Song of My Cell Phone. Obviously, there's a play on Song of Myself with Walt Whitman, and there are various Ginsberg allusions in here. And actually, Garrison Keillor did read this on the Writer's Almanac a couple months ago. Song of My Cell Phone. I have seen the best minds of my generation clunking into buildings and strolling into traffic, wandering the streets, looking for an angry fix, more likes, more followers, better looking faces on the dating apps. Called away? I'm always called away. Whatever is not in my presence, more filled with hope and promise than what is in my presence. Guilty, I have lain with my beloved, unable to resist the beep and bring, the breaking news, the time and temperature. In which destructive element should I immerse? There are so many destructive elements, the one beneath my feet, which is plenty destructive. And then all the other destructive elements, horrible, gory, brilliant, super empowering, alive in the world of code. Who today memorizes a phone number, reads a map, or calculates a tip in their head? I've lost those skills because my smartphone has made me a moron. And now I depend on my brain extension device for just about everything. Friends, I burst into your day, calling, texting. How are you? How is your health? What did you eat for breakfast? I sing the life electronic. Those I love engirth me with their emails, and I engirth them with my emails. Yet I miss the corded phones of yesteryear with their clear reception and multiple extensions. And where have all the payphones gone that stood on street corners? Yours for a dime, then a quarter, then a lot more money. So great for making anonymous phone calls. I picture the orbiting angels miles above Earth, sending me signals, watching over me, maybe watching me too much. Oh, phone, what is the soul but this eternal life in the cloud, from which nothing vanishes, not even my most embarrassing photos and confessions, or misaddressed text messages, or overly emotional explosions that seemed so pithy at the time. Oh, reader, should you find these lines on a cell phone, I celebrate our connection and sing our connection. If you are the cell phone, I hope that you will not be cross with me, or if you are, forgive me with all your speed. Now, I've been playing around with some formal poetry, some received forms, and I wrote a couple of, thank you guys, I wrote a couple of rondelles. So rondelles are petite French forms. They have a special rhyme scheme and some repeating refrain lines. And this one is Amorpho Menelaus. So amorphos are those beautiful blue iridescent butterflies from the American tropics, and there are different kinds of morphos. So this one's Amorpho Menelaus. I thought my life would be complete if I found a morpho in the wild. I hatched my dream when, as a child, I learned of butterflies that beat their blue wings in the jungle heat. It would take years and many miles to try to make my life complete by finding a morpho in the wild. On the Napo River, a fleet iridescence passed before my eyes. Its azure foil, a patch of sky, almost low enough to reach. I thought my life would be complete. And this other rondel is a love poem. It's called The Consummate Hour. In the ghostly consummate hour, when your body's next to mine, we rest as tree and troubled vine, mulling the likely horror of never having found each other. Never finding happens all the time. In the ghostly consummate hour, I like your body next to mine. The lost years will never be ours, but we won't dwell on that. We'll find our autumn as gold as springtime. We'll live like bees and flowers at home in our consummate hours. So some of you may remember back in 1999, thanks everybody, back in 1999, a certain criminal wormed his way out of a Pennsylvania jail and was on the lam for, I think, 2 weeks. And he became kind of an anti-hero because he was outwitting the police and he was free for a while. And people would kind of cheer him on and the front page of the Inquirer always talked about him. So he was eventually caught. He was a bad guy, but kind of an anti-hero. So I have named him Sleepless Johnston, and this is a ballad, also a formal poem. When the city lights came on and the air turned gray, Sleepless Johnston finished filing through his bars and ran away. He flew through Pennsylvania in a green hot-wired Olds, made a dummy on his cot made of prison clothes, had coins to call his cousins and marathon running shoes, the gifts of a nurse who loved him or wanted some of his loot. Johnston, they said, had millions tied up in high-tech stocks or hidden away in Cayman banks or stuffed in a cardboard box. But maybe he had nothing and was after black revenge, was weary of doing life in jail and had to go home again. He dreamed his mom would fry him eggs, let him bathe and sleep, a good long sleep to die for on daisy-covered sheets. But Johnston was a menace, a thief and murderer as well. He shot 3 young men at least and killed a teenage girl. 40 grand the lawmen promised, a price they swore they'd pay to any soul who would help them catch this cunning runaway. In a tavern, a trooper saw him having a smoke and a beer, but Sleepless fled like a vision of Elvis when the cop came near. Oh, there were plenty of sightings, though most of them were fake. Line workers called in phony clues for Slippery Johnston's sake. He haunted all the payphones begging cousins for a bed. Yet most hung up when Sleepless rang. At last one kinsman said, "The law has us surrounded. You can't come over here. Keep running, man. Wing like a bat or hide like a deer." But after 20 years in jail, familiar woods were few. Developers had subdivided the countryside he knew. Patrol cars right behind him, in front the rising sun. Johnston dashed on a cul-de-sac. Folks called 911. No dogs, no guns, no searchlights, only rest and peace were the things that Sleepless wanted as he walked to the police and gave up by a birdbath, exhausted, nearly dead. Sleepless held out his 2 hands for cuffs, some chow, a bed. He hadn't any millions, just his pants and shirt and those fancy track shoes and the lost hope of the nurse. Thank you. All right, shifting gears again, quite radically. This one's called Dilaudid. Dilaudid is a heavy narcotic. And it has an epigraph that comes from a Roman Catholic poem. It's Timor Mortis Conturbat Me, which means fear of death disturbed me. Dilaudid. When on my deathbed once Dilaudid knocked me back to the black cat's fur, time spilt its ink and the dark prince took me on my narrow hospital gurney. All was fathoms. I cared not for calendars or clocks, desk or garden, or if I saw my husband more. I only knew the snake no longer flogged my gut. The dripped potassium no longer seared my veins. My soul was calm, desire gone, and fear death did not disturb me. Then hours, maybe a whole day passed. I came to, morninged by the midnight sun of the nurse's station. Easy, friendly talk of picnics and weekends at the shore lapped at my ears. I thought of Dilaudid, the drug I loved, the hero drug, its foot upon the neck of pain. I didn't need it anymore, but could have asked, been zeroed back. Known again the long black arms, the soul washed out to sea. But I knew envy then, envy of days that others picked like plums from countless trees, and fear of death disturbed me. I am also very fond of the mythical character Lilith, and Lilith was said to be the first wife of Adam before Eve. She's not in the Bible. She does come from ancient Middle Eastern mythology, and she's been retold in various legends throughout time. So she and Adam were married. It was a very rocky marriage, and they quarreled a lot and got divorced, and she became sort of a witch or an enchantress who flew around the universe having sex with men in their sleep and causing the deaths of babies and just wreaking havoc all over the universe. But a lot of feminists, including myself, think that she's been given a bad rap due to misogynistic reasons. And so a lot of us kind of try to rescue her and see her differently. So here she is. Oh, and I like to put her in contemporary times. So this is Lilith. Lilith tries online dating. Very modern person. Well past the first blush of feminine decline, centuries past, in fact, yet looking only 62, retired from the night shift and thirsting for comfort, consolation, Lilith considers the possibility of long-term companionship. She yearns to be half of an old couple, to live with a man tolerating his habits with an annoyance close to affection, trusting that he will endure her with similar warmth. Incessant as the ocean waves, this need laps at her feet. For pity's sake, her latest crop of girlfriends has died or gone to Florida. The road ahead blurs, arthritis rusts her gears. Worst of all, those pratfalls into the pool of forgetfulness and the attempts to laugh them off. So Lilith does what other single women do. She signs up for an online dating service, a Jewish one. An odd choice for one to whom the tradition has been cruel, maligning her as the witch of midnight sex. But the great chain of Jewish being means something to Lilith. She's stubborn that way, even though she knows that there are many fine Gentiles out there and everyone is mixing nowadays. She uploads a fairly recent photo, lists herself as divorced, no children, lies about her age, posts a profile that makes no mention of her lusty past, no clue that her fountain has run dry. Soon the flirts, the looks, the messages pour in. Hope begins to peck its way out of its tough shell. She feels like a woman again. And this is how it unfolds. First date, coffee, during which the fellow goes on about himself. Second date, pizza. Here, various warning lights flash on the get-to-know-you dashboard, but these Lilith chooses to ignore. Third date, dinner, following which the guy requests sex or a timeline. Four, same. I'm a guy, Steve or Jeff says, his denim bumping up against her. But as soon as she tells Steve or Jeff that she doesn't want to rush, it's goodbye and good luck. Lilith knows that a man's desire surges, but his days are few. She, on the other hand, will live for generations. She prays, not really believing in divine intervention, that in a generation to come, a man might invite her for a third date, demanding nothing, a fourth date, demanding the same nothing, a fifth, again requesting nothing. Finally, out of gratitude and relief and a sense of being understood, she will fall into his arms. He will comfort and console her as she will comfort and console him. And then perhaps the fountain play again in the desert of all those years. Thank you. Thank you.
Wow, another round of applause for Lynn Levin. I want to hear more poems, but we have a bunch of people on the docket and included in this reading. Thank you so much, Lynn, for fantastic range of genres and styles, incredible. You have to pick up her new book, people, and know that you're looking at the number of people on here who run reading series. They're all going to be coming back online if they aren't already. Dave Worrell runs a series in the bookstore over in Haddonfield, and Chris Ann runs the New Voices series at Shakespeare. She's on here with Alina, runs her incredible series through Moonstone, and Sean Lynch is back there. So incredible, not to mention our reader After Warren, who has done close to 100 Zoom readings since this thing started. So Peter's coming up next after Warren, but we're gonna wave a magic wand and bring in Warren Longmire, who is one of the only poets who can appear in two places at once. He's actually appearing here at the exact same time that he's appearing at a haiku reading in Camden. So we're about to see how that works. Warren Longmire is a writer, expert whistler, a pushcart nominee, and a former poetry editor at Apiary magazine. He's been published all over the place: Painted Bride Quarterly, 11/11, two chapbooks out, Ripped Winters, and Due Until True. He currently splits his time between web programming, music, and writing Tumblr poems. His essays, videos, and sounds can be found on Tumblr and SoundCloud. And like I said, he's able to translocate. So here he is in one of those locations, Warren Longmire.
Hey, what's up, everybody? Your friendly neighborhood Warren is here. And so great to be able to be a part of all of this. It's super hot inside of my room. My air conditioner is probably on the fritz. I don't know, sometimes I go in there and it's just ice cold, and other times it's just like there's absolutely nothing and I'm just sitting there naked all the time, and nothing really helps. I loved the summer up until 2020. I loved a lot of things up until 2020. I got 15% on my laptop right now, so I probably should get into the poems. This is backyard of my house. This right here is the most beautiful tree that I've ever seen in my life. It's 300 years old, and it's just plopped in the middle of a West Philadelphia, a Southwest Philadelphia, a fence. So a little something to share that you couldn't get if this was in person. So there are some pluses. Let's do some poems. This is actually super new. It's based on a music session that I recently had with a friend. And it's the first thing I've written in a little while that I feel really good about. Hey everybody, quick note from Future Warren. When I say that I feel really good about it, that actually was a little strong. Like, I feel like it's, you know, it appeals to me in a certain kind of way the more that I said it. And doing it a cappella without music was also pretty great. So I just wanted to qualify a little bit that statement. Also on my wall, it says, do more of what makes you happy. And I think that's always good news. Here comes a poem. It is untitled. And when my eyes close, see the vibes rise, shoots of rhizomes guiding where the blind drive, shoot of sun ray moving through a tar sky, tarmac clearing for the landing of a magpie. In the land of the ragged and the sagging, a middle finger perches in the stare of a stranger, a mediocre sandwich full of spam from the corner, the scratch-off tickets spent raining down like confetti. It's a trap, Fetty Wap with the gimp eye, drunk uncle dances invisible to the family, chin-strapped surgical mask on asthmatics, blue-black feet puffing out loose orthotics, Black Lives Matter abstract carbon patterns, Black death scattered on all local channels, Black girls scatter, Black boys, Black decanters, Black noise parrots out mouths like jazz standards. This is a similar poem, also kind of dedicated to Black death, I guess you could say. It's from a series that I made about bebop, and it's about the death of Charlie Parker. It's called Shakespeare, Belt Around His Arm, Baroness House, and a Key and Peele Marathon. Reality's new, very clearly within me, suddenly revelation sketch I, sketch vistas the uninitiated I, gather thunderheads instantaneously, I outlive, I both in the moment and afterwards, I, and I still boy, not merely will, free movements dawn, I always free, I dawn free will, and not merely boy, I still not merely I, he pleaded, let's get together again. I, before it's too late, I anything, I heard, I heard someone, I anything, I. Ain't nothing wrong with loving yourself, just love more. Love more than yourself and you'll be fine. And if you ain't really fine with that, then at least admit that there's nothing wrong with love and giving it. Nothing wrong with saying I love you anytime the word springs to your mind. It don't have to be all the time and mean it. You don't have to love all the time, but if it does spring to mind, there ain't nothing wrong with saying it. Wrong things happen all the time, like wrong turns at least in the alleys they lead you down, in the monsters that stalk them, huge and intransitory, especially in that alleyway just ahead. Maybe I love this road too much, and does that make love wrong? Does that make it wrong to love the monster, some monster, and look it dead in the eyes and kiss it like a fool or an angel or the poor? Ain't got to. Ain't nobody got to do nothing because nobody knows no one and no one ever will until Jesus Rambos a nor'easter or maybe Satan farts. Until my brain is in the cloud in your hard drive and we are all blinking in the server upstairs. I don't know what you could do to me. You don't know what I could do to you. All I'm saying is that does that mean there's something wrong with love? Like killing the bat of a tree, censoring the shade of a blood or a crypt, of saying that means the color's wrong. Ain't nothing wrong with saying I love you, man. I love you, man. And it makes me so full with spirit, every brainless joy that lights your sweet face. Ain't nothing wrong with that to everyone who is man or what was what man was once thought to be. Ain't nothing wrong with still. Ain't nothing wrong with this one small piece, elastic and tight, inside my undershirt, a gem on the end of a necklace, hard and cool. Ain't nothing wrong with you when you love, when you choose to love, no matter where it goes, ain't nothing wrong with you. Wrong turns happen all the time, and most I don't know nothing about no one and never will, but that, but it ain't wrong in and of itself. And when a freak chill wind billows through a sticky July night, that's wrong. in an untouched Thursday snow hill full of deer this past March in the morning Norristown train ride. That's wrong. And pickle juice and vodka is wrong. And the process is wrong, but you trust it. And look what it do. And your hair is a mess. And my jacket is stained. And you're pissing me off, but I love you. Ain't nothing wrong with that. Ain't nothing wrong. Whew. I am... Yeah, I'm a lot of things.
Things to do when you're alone. 1. Dance to the song that got stuck in your head. Talk on the phone to everyone but. Compose the song. Remember the wrong parts. Spit at the mirror and smile clean. It's the surest way to find missing things. Pretend there's no gravity while deep in almost sleep. Induce vertigo and swell the energy of your arm to some cartoonish size. Your arms can move mountains in your mind. Snack. Be aware of the passage of time. Wank. Enjoy the moment between being clean and becoming dry. The world is your musical instrument. Listen. Bleed as green as you feel like. Take a walk among strangers. It still counts. Seed. Sleep. Insist the words come. Resist the temptation to stop. Remember bunk beds. Remember backwoods logs and slipping onto moss. She misses dirt, your grandma. Built her a garden. There's so much to live in today. Write it up. Love is self-evident once you stop expecting anything, so stop. Boredom is nothing to fear. Wait. Breathe. Clichés can be okay if no one knows. Steal. Remember this is only a start. Remember freedom is embracing the failures. This is the best that it's going to get. This is enough.
Hey, what's up, everybody? So my laptop just about ran out of memory while I was outside. I actually read two more poems after that, but it wasn't working the way I wanted it to anyway. So I ended up coming back inside, and that video was something that I made for a one-man show that I did 7 years ago over in, just while I was here in Philly, like a medley of poems. And behind that is the Bad Pluses, pound for pound, I think. I'm gonna do one more poem for you. I actually kind of just wanna find it. I'm recording over Zoom right now, as all of you are chilling on Zoom. Might as well feel like we're in the same place, even though I am simultaneously at a completely different open mic right now. I'm so sorry that the double booking happened like that. Yeah. It was definitely booked beforehand. I'm not exactly sure what the timeline was with everything. And doing program management within the context of a virtual environment is obviously still kinks. You know, a lot of the same processes aren't there. I love you all. Oh my God, I love Moonstone so much. Let's see if I can find this poem and not stumble upon some folder that none of y'all need to see. Never talk. X. Let's see. What was that in? Freaking frick. This is all gold, but it's like taking way too long. Poems. There's another X poem that I definitely could do. I think I put it inside Stutters. Stutters were all these really disturbing poems that I wrote after, it was like a breakup between breakups. Most of these poems nobody's ever read before. Here we go, this is it. I like the way it looked, so I wanted y'all to be able to see it. Poem in two parts. Never talk about your ex or pain.
Never talk about your ex or pain. Nothing but this and bliss. You deserve the whole world inside your head exist or you don't. I love you. I'm astray. I'm obsessed. I can't live in there. The air is too graphic. But if you really love me, open the black door by the red gate. Or please just describe the rocks lodged in your pathway. Or I'll have to tell you about the graffitied wall haloing your face and wait for a deadbolt to click. Never talk about your pain or X. The wall around my face is made of Gorilla Glass for West Philly and walnut crown molding. I had a detached retina installed in the West Wing when I was depressed. I am gloriously broken and soprano. Honest chaos, all my songs, none of them are yours, but I love the tilt of your head when they spring a picture of Play-Doh smashed clumsily on to the Sunday funny pages. You are gloriously asymmetric, a stubborn weed, broad-treed, unkempt, an animal. I am not a fan of landscaping. I like armpit hair. I always show up undressed. My chest is full and blushed every sentence. I am the smallest possible dent, the ant, man, and dirt is where my riches lay. I want to be rich and mulched into your childhood redwood base, a millisecond of your tears angle, a tear in space-time as a small glitch where our lips lie and the lies are not small enough. If you have to half it in half my rib, in half my things, and half my brain is yours, but never the sky. Thank you, Moonstone. Keep shining. I can't wait to be at the next reading. And Godspeed to all of us. I love you. Bye-bye.
Really nice job being able to see Warren's work, hear Warren talk about his work while he was delivering his work, kind of meta thing going on. The only thing more than that would have been piping into his haiku reading in Camden during that reading. That's for next time. So in the interest of time, let's get on to the next reader and really appreciate Peter Murphy, your patience and you're making your time for this today. Peter was born in Wales and grew up in New York, but has been in this area for a long time, doing a lot. Like I said, he's been running readings after readings after readings over there online. He pivoted and made it happen. He's the author of 11 books and chapbooks of poetry and prose, including Meantime. You got to order all these books, people, if you haven't gotten them. Looking for Thelma, recently published by Moonstone Press. His poems and essays have appeared in The Common, Dio, Guernica, Hippocampus, The Literary Review, Rattle, elsewhere. The founder of Murphy Writing of Stockton University, you know all the programs that he's done supporting new writers. He leads workshops for writers and teachers in the United States and abroad, where he would be if he wasn't here right now with us, Peter Murphy. Please welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Aaron, for inviting me. Thank you, Larry, for organizing this. And thank you, Justin, for doing all of the magic. That's really wonderful. Also like to thank my fellow readers. That was really wonderful. I'm sorry I have to come after you and not before Lynn, Elijah, and Warren. So I will try to live up to it. The first few poems I'm going to read is from a book called I Thought I Was Going to Be Okay, from Diode Editions. Came out about 3 or 4 years ago. And the speaker in these poems, he's not okay. The first is called Good Grief. I wake from a nap where I dreamt I was crucified upside down to find night has already fallen. Like Edison, I'm afraid of the dark. Below the slot in my front door, a pile of envelopes. A direct mail Jesus urges me to pray and donate. TransUnion wants to sell me my credit score. Facing history insists I consider my moral choices. I let my newspaper go when it misprinted control thought as control throughout. On television, a bee wrangler deconstructs why the queen is kept fat and happy at the expense of workers who produce honey. Marx might object, but didn't he say, I'm not a Marxist. Edison, I don't believe. Einstein, I don't believe in mathematics. Every 3 seconds, someone writes a poem about love. 6 times an hour, a dog gets hit by a car. In 17 minutes, somebody else will be killed by a gun. It's hard to remember that Amazon used to be a river. The last time I felt this way this long, death stopped at several houses in the neighborhood to ask for something sweet. I want to believe the sun is a star and we spin around it. I want to believe I have a soul that whirls on after death. I want to believe that Marx at the Royal Buffet would go light on the soup and rice, stuffing himself instead on crab legs, pork, a heaping plate of the jumbo shrimp. Foreclosure. Used to be, I could get anything I wanted delivered to my door in 24 hours. Now, my closets are full of smoke, and I'm showing symptoms of anonymous fever. I hear the laugh track of adventure capitalists flaunting their new talking dogs. I lose sleep, gain weight, and confuse the death toll with the death tax. I become obsessed with the online poll to assassinate the president and the blunt force drama it inflicts on the soul. When I suffered from restless prick syndrome, I excused myself by thinking I needed more, but that was before I understood dying gracefully is a myth. After a lunch of peace and happiness noodles, I digest my paper fortune. Good luck with your tumor, which would be funny if it were funny. God bless, goddamn, don't let it end like this. Let me do something. Forgive me. I've never felt better. I'm going to read a couple of sonnets. This first is called Testimony. And if you don't know where the word testimony comes from, where it's derived, I'm afraid you're about to find out. Testimony. If you were Roman and ancient, you had to put one hand on your scrotum when swearing an oath. It didn't matter that women didn't have them because women didn't matter, at least until the 20th century, or was it the 13th century when the Magna Carta ponied up? The Hundred Years' War lasted 116 years. The Beatles used the word love 613 times in one song. That must have been in all their songs. And did you know that Marvin Gardens is spelled wrong on a Monopoly board? Parker Brothers apologized, but refused to change it. Elvis was a seventh degree black belt. Hitler had only one testicle, enough to swear by, but you shouldn't believe anything he tried to tell you. Clocks made before 1660 had only one hand. And this sonnet is called Kaput. I think you know what that means. When an eagle mistook Aeschylus' bald head for a stone, it dropped a tortoise from on high, crushing his skull. Li Po, trying to kiss the reflection of the moon in a river, fell out of his boat and drowned. Martin of Aragon succumbed from uncontrollable laughing. Ivan the Terrible had a stroke while playing chess. Thomas Merton grazed an electric fan, stepping out of his bath. Tennessee Williams choked on a bottle cap. Sherwood Anderson swallowed a toothpick. Harry Houdini had someone punch him in the stomach. Elvis, Lenny Bruce, and Jim Morrison overdosed in the bathroom, but not at the same time. Jimmy and Janice overdosed in their bedrooms. They didn't have to go. This is going to be a real change of mood and tone. This is from Meantime, which was published last September by Moonstone Press. Thank you, Larry. This poem is called In Due Time. Lately, I've been watching the 24-hour webcam where Mr. President and the First Lady, a pair of bald eagles, take turns feeding their young. She rips a dead rat into pieces the little one can swallow. He offers it an alewife still quivering in his talons. I wasted a day to see if the fledgling, its leg wedged between sticks in the nest, died or got free. Some praised the men who climbed the 80-foot poplar to rescue it. Others condemned them, said they should let nature take its course. Mostly, Mr. President and the First Lady live apart. He flies over a swamp that needs to be drained. She perches on a tower looking down at the world, grooming her son to take his father's place. I was in Cardiff, Wales, about 3.5 years ago when the Manchester bombing, Ariana Grande's concert was bombed. And the next evening after the bombing, went to a performance of The Crucible. And this is a poem that came out of it. It's a kind of guzzle. And you'll notice that they're, the last line of each couplet rhymes or has a similar word or sound. It's called Watching the Crucible in the Time of Trump at Theatre Newith, Cardiff. First of all, everyone is terrified. Is she going to fly again? I hear she flies. The word lies, lies inside of flies, inside of families. A clink of good women are shackled together away from their families because of lies. No president in history has been treated more unfairly. No president in history believed himself so wise. I said I see the devil and they believe me. I say, even the most sensible sometimes believe a lie. The extremists of opposing beliefs lie closer to each other than they do to their own allies. When he called the investigation a witch hunt, the congressman from Salem said that was a lie. Apocryphal, I suspect, that the Black Panthers and the KKK raged together against race unity rallies. But the true believer is a murderer, not a martyr, when he explodes himself in his desire to terrorize. They were actors playing their roles until at the curtain call, they broke the fourth wall for the Manchester dead and hospitalized. The word casual and ties survive in casualties. This time, bombs are going off all over the city, first this street and that street, and soon I begin to think there are more bombs than streets. This is how terror works. It wants me to believe the man slicing lamb at the kebab shop is planning to slice me. It wants me to believe thousands and thousands are cheering on rooftops. Terror doesn't want me to know I'm more likely to be crushed by a truck as I walk home from work, more likely to be shot by the gun my wife keeps cocked under her pillow. What I don't understand is how living in this country makes me exceptional. What I don't understand is how anyone can say, God tells them to kill. I want to go to the ocean. I want to forget everything I know. I want the water to refresh my sweltering body. I want to swim out past the salty horizon and not let the waves roll me back to terra firma where terrorists have tripwired the sand. Listen, what I'm trying to say is thank God they didn't think to blow up a church in Birmingham or a federal building in Oklahoma. Thank God they didn't think to blow up the heartland, the salt of the earth, the middle of this country that doesn't trust its coasts. Thank God they don't know how much we already fear each other. I suspect that there may be a number of teachers in the audience, and I'm probably certain that a number of you were students as well. This is a school poem, and all of the quotes in here, unfortunately, they're true. They really were told to me by various people, various administrators. This is called Doing Time. Each week, my supervisor rejected my lesson plans because my goals and objectives were the same. When I asked him to explain the difference, he changed the subject. When I asked why the syllabus makes no sense, he said, "You're not being paid to think. You're being paid to deliver a curriculum." When I asked how to teach teenagers who can't read to read, he put a hand on the shoulder and with the other pointed towards the horizon, which happened to be the men's room at the end of the corridor, and said, "Take them where they are." When I turned to ask what that meant, he was gone. I figured he was off to help another teacher or meet a parent. But when I saw him first in line at the lunch counter, I knew I was wrong again. I also knew I wasn't meant to teach anything important to the dark-skinned students that sat in front of me. Like them, I was meant to fail. And because I was teaching stupid kids, I figured I must be stupid too. Even if I wanted to, I'd never be promoted to supervisor like him. So I thought, screw it. And I read my kids a poem about nature, and they said, "Man, that's dumb." So I read them a poem about love, and they said, "Man, that's stupid." So I read them a poem about sports, and they said, "Man, that's nice." So I read them a poem about death, and they said, "Man, that's deep." Then I read them a poem that said something about their lives they didn't know they knew. And they said, "Let me hold that," pulling it from my hands, reading it over and over, until they said, "Why ain't nobody ever told us this shit before?" And I said, "You've got to be careful. If they know how much you really know, instead of more schools, they'll build more prisons to teach you a lesson." And I'm going to read some new poems. This is from a series, they're double sonnets. Now, this is really ambitious. And they're about the stars. And I know nothing about the stars, so I figured I would just make stuff up. And in making stuff up, I think I came across a few things that might actually be true. The series of these is called The Book of Stars. And this first is the title poem, The Book of Stars. Although the sun is almost a perfect sphere, and more than a million Earths can fit inside, it is considered to be an ordinary star. Does this disappoint you? Were you hoping it was exceptional? There may be more stars in the universe than there are atoms on Earth. About this, I'm not sure, but I'm certain there are more stars than grains of sand or drops of water. The light from these stars takes millions of years to reach the Earth. When you see this light, imagine you're looking at your own history. Did you know that asterisk means little star? Disaster, bad star. The sun is middle-aged. Until the 16th century, it revolved around the Earth, around us. This means we were wrong. It is a second-generation star. This means much of the bright material inside it and inside ourselves was once part of a larger star that no longer exists. This means that the sun one day, and we also one day, will no longer exist. Does this make you sad? Were you hoping we would last forever? Consider means to observe the stars. Desire, to await the stars. What more would you like to know? The Diaspora of Light. When he saw it shooting from the eyes of his students, Plato realized that, like imagination, light must be restrained. So he tried to chain it in a cave like the wild thing it is, and invented stories to explain the folly of perception. This light has traveled far to ignite us, and because it is always moving, it cannot be held or saved. You might say its greatest strength is that it knows it is dying. And when it does, it breaks into a million colors. Does it sadden you to learn that goldfish see more of these colors than you do? Bees, birds, lizards, they too see what you cannot see. When we were one-celled and luminescent in the pond that spawned us, there was no space in our peculiar jelly for doubt to metastasize. Why then, knowing our brilliance would fade, did we abandon that world to walk upright? Our folly is that we believe we would be happy in exile, far from a homeland to which we will never return. Is it a strength for you or a weakness? Knowing you will die. Is this why, when light ebbs during the cooler months, you find it difficult to lift your body from your bed, and you cannot stem the tide of water leaking from your eyes? Two more. This title here is a horrible title. It's a terrible pun. Forgive me for this. Stars Poetica. I couldn't resist. The first thing you notice is how lonely they are. What they desire consumes you. Pardon me. What they desire consumes them. Who knows how long their longing lasts? They come from dust like us, and to dust they will return. Forget what you were told about their twinkling. When their magnificent voices begin to trill, their songs flicker. Love, after all, attracts dust to dust, flame to flame. Who knows what a second means to them, a century? Whatever questions you may have, you should know. They have the same questions. Of course, when they wish, they do not wish upon themselves, but they do wish to be held, knowing nothing can hold them. To be held means to be restrained or consoled, like Boethius awaiting execution in a cell in Pavia. He consoled himself composing his song. O happy race of mortals, if your hearts are ruled, as is the universe, by love. Our love, both too soft and too loud, is more than love, and dust is more than dust. As you wipe it from the credenza, as you brush it with your hand from your lapel, you must never forget, you too were once on fire. And this last poem is called The Resentment of Stars, and I'd like to give a shout out to Milo, who's in the audience, who helped me with this. The Resentment of Stars. If fire were stolen by a god who is tortured for saving us, then this must be what it means to love. But no, it is just a bit of star that will never forgive us for pulling it out of the sky. This is why fire snaps at our fingers when we try to hold it. This is why it will never love us, even though ours is the only atmosphere in which it can breathe. And why should it? How have we ever employed it but to build and destroy, build and destroy? When you were a child, you didn't see the flame on the gleaming object of your desire, so you grasped what you should never have grasped, thinking it would please you. Instead, discharge from your blistering palm soiled your father's handkerchief. Betrayal has taught you how to live on molten rock that's covered mostly by ocean, taught you what a fragile engine the body is, taught you to trust no person, no thing, no matter how bright and gleaming. Forget the virtuous martyrs whose blood soiled the fabric of your imagination. Forget those saints crucified upside down, their skulls cracked open by axes, their hearts cleaved from their bodies set aflame. And that giver of flame? Forget him too. Each day his liver is clawed out by talons, dispatched by those who once loved him. And you, when you were young and virtuous, even then, how could you ever doubt that the stars are on fire? Thank you all.
Oh, beautiful work. Beautiful work, Peter. All of you, keep the applause going for Peter Murphy, Elijah Pringle, Lynn Levin, and Aaren Longmire. And make sure you get on their websites and buy their books. And make sure you go on to moonstoneartscenter.org and keep yourself posted about the other upcoming readings that are coming down the pike, and keep doing this, because this is what's going to keep us healthy enough to ride this out. I can't wait to hear the next 100 poems from you four and from everybody on this call. So let's give a round of applause to Larry for keeping this thing going against all odds. And he's about to come out with some other new programs. So keep an eye on moonstonearchcenter.org. And thank you for coming tonight. This will